SpaceX Starship updates and countdown to Mars, Perseverance's last days on Earth. My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It? And as always, there has been a lot happening in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. That's what I always say, right? That's what I've said for 100 episodes now, and still you and me, we find ourselves returning to this over and over again. I don't want to say too much, as I know that some will be very impatient to get to the content as quick as possible, and you can skip ahead of this. You can skip. Yeah, but I want to at least take the time to thank you sitting in front of your smartphone, TV, or PC right now watching me. I've never really gotten used to the feeling of being watched by so many, and I most likely never will, but I still want to thank you for enabling me to do what I do for a living. It's an honor and a heck of a ride. Just a few days ago, I got an email from Leonard, traveling the world with his family, telling me that he uses my episodes as homeschooling content for his kids. These are the moments that make me realize how impactful and important my uploads can be. I take a bow for all of you, and I hope you're having a great time wherever you're watching this. All right, enough of the crazy talk. Without further ado, here's episode 100 for all of you. You rock! Starship updates. And here we are again, watching some guys in the Texan sun building our dreams, maybe even our future. Boca Chica, Starship, SpaceX. Who could have predicted this 10 years ago? Well, besides Elon Musk, I guess. Recently, Mary, aka Boca Chica Gal, did a drive-by of the SpaceX Boca Chica facility, and of course I watched it. Memories of my trip down to Texas came to my mind, and thoughts about how much has already changed again since my visit in March. An ever-changing and evolving site, almost like a living organism. Constantly adapting to new needs and development changes. Trying out different ways of figuring out what a Starship must look like. And this is the core of what makes all of this so different. It's no legacy hardware. No tested and proven technology. This is a project where questions are being formulated and solutions to these questions grow and evolve over time. This is the definition of research and development. And right now the launch site is undergoing heavy evolution again. There are two launch pads at the moment. The test pad we already know very well, and a new pad being built right now. SpaceX's approach often involves building provisional infrastructure at first due to the development team not knowing exactly what the finished vision will look like. We've seen this many times before. Start the idea small and go big later to save resources. And the same strategy applies to the launch pads. What you can see here is the beginning of something we've seen already, in an animation. In the animation though, size is really hard to put into perspective. To stack, fuel and launch a Starship with a super heavy booster, you need a very strong support structure. And that is what SpaceX is building here right now. This huge rebar cage, for example, is most likely the support for the main tower, which will include the crew access arm, crane, fuel lines and many other systems needed for an orbital launch site. Since the ground in Boca Chica consists of sand and mud, the support structure needs to be driven deep into the soil to be able to provide enough stability for the weight that will rest on it. So SpaceX is taking the safe approach by making a rebar reinforced concrete foundation that goes deep down. After this, construction on the surface will take place, which will be incredibly interesting as we have yet to know how close the animation is to what we'll see being built here. And on we go with more improvement to the launch site. Do you remember how I talked about ground erosion at the fuel farm on a recent episode and how SpaceX will have to do something about it rather soon? Here we go. SpaceX is getting rid of yet another dirt patch on their properties. The fuel farm and test pad area right now is a large dirt plateau. One of those provisional solutions from when they just started developing the site. This is about to change now. Besides reinforcing the slope, SpaceX is building yet another solid structure right next to the tank farm. Although it's not yet known what this structure will be, there's one indicator for possible use. Yet another sign has gone up at the launch site. It reads future home for SpaceX Launch Control Center. Here you can see one of the best aerial views of the launch site to date. Awesome job, RGV Aerial. Consider becoming their patron to support the next flight. Links in the description, and I'm a patron myself. So this is presumably where the construction for the new launch control center is going to be. Here's the current test launch stand, and this is where the new large launch structure is being built. One thing quickly becomes clear. The planned launch control center is much too close to the current test stand. If a Starship explodes with fuel in the tanks, as we've seen recently with serial number 4, a control center so close to the launch pad would take heavy damage every time something goes wrong, and serial number 4's RUD might not be the largest explosion Boca Chica will see in the future. As prototyping work is destined to have anomalies. So my speculation here, as there is no official word yet, is that SpaceX will very quickly build the new launch site and shift testing over to the new pad as soon as possible to not endanger the control center right next to the current test site. This in return means that a lot of construction will have to happen here in the near future. A control center, a large new launch pad, a fuel farm that either needs repositioning or extension of the fuel lines towards the new pad, and so forth. At the same time, serial number 7 got another test run with liquid nitrogen. Same procedure as every time. LN2 got filled into the test tank, large amounts of ice built up on the outside, and at a certain point, SpaceX workers closed all the valves to maximize pressure as much as possible. These tests are meant to go beyond the limits to get a feel for how much pressure a particular construction method can take, and SpaceX succeeded in finding that limit. Due to the test tank being firmly strapped down to the jig it was standing on, the tank just did a very small hop, but it managed to jump and land on its side. Shortly after the test had concluded, SpaceX's Boston Dynamics spot, named Zeus by the SpaceX workers, inspected the site. It can be equipped with all sorts of sensors, including gas detectors, so it's the ideal tool to do a first inspection for hazard assessment. It's not known yet how much pressure the tank reached, but SpaceX, as always, was incredibly fast to proceed after the test was done. Because just one day later, on Wednesday, SpaceX rolled out serial number 5 out of the high bay towards the launch site. It's always pretty majestic to see these large tank stacks roll out to the test stand, and many were watching again on several live streams. Once arrived at the launch site, it got lifted onto the newly rebuilt test stand, and work is ongoing to prepare it for its first test runs right now. If there is any trend to the recent test candidates, SN5 should do very well after serial number 4's many successful static fires and pressure tests. I don't dare to say that this one will fly, but in theory it should. So fingers crossed, let's do this, SpaceX. And if you want to get more info about SpaceX's Starship development, details about what exactly they're doing, and lots of other interesting insights into Blue Origin, NASA, Rocket Lab, and many other launch providers and their rockets, I suggest you check out my quickly growing library of episodes. While you're at it, do not forget to hit the like button wherever you see it, and please do subscribe if you have not done so yet. This shows the YouTube algorithm that you actually appreciate my work, and in return enables me to make more content for you. Thank you! One thing is for sure, SpaceX is not slowing down at all. There's nothing in spaceflight history that can really be compared to what's happening at this remote place in the United States right now, and it's very likely that 50 years from now, people will look back at these events as we do now to Redstone, Gemini, and Apollo. SpaceX, you rock! Countdown to Mars, Percy's last days on Earth. The clock is ticking for yet another milestone in space exploration. Perseverance, the Mars 2020 rover, is living out its last days on Earth, getting ready for the journey of its lifetime, a field trip to Mars. It's been a while since NASA has sent a rover to Mars. Curiosity landed in 2011 and has been at work since then, discovering groundbreaking new insights about Mars along its winding path on the Martian surface. Finally, we're very close to the next rover taking off towards the Red Planet. And Perseverance is the most advanced and heaviest yet. Announced on December 4th of 2012, the Mars 2020 mission has come a long way. Including new science instruments and a flying mini-helicopter, the mission will no doubt set the bar for robotic exploration of the solar system a bit higher yet again. Fully integrated into its descent stage now and waiting for the launch, Perseverance has recently received a very emotional plaque. Engineers have attached a COVID-19 Perseverance plate to the port side of the rover. It has our globe on it, with the mission leaving towards Mars, and under it is a very familiar symbol. The Stefan Serpent, or Rod of Asclepius. It is the international symbol of medical personnel, and it is on the plaque to honor the great service these people have done to humanity over the last several months. Well done, NASA, this is a fine gesture. Not only the rover is being prepared for launch, though. United Launch Alliance is working towards the launch as well. As a fun fact, all US rovers have been launched either with a Delta or an Atlas rocket. So all of them were launched by United Launch Alliance. Tori, if you're watching this, you rock. And Perseverance is getting a shiny Atlas 5541 for its launch towards Mars. For those who do not know, the three numbers behind the name are indicators for the configuration, as Atlas 5 is a very versatile launch vehicle. 5 stands for 5-meter fairing, 4 stands for 4 solid rocket boosters, and 1 stands for the number of engines on the upper stage. What you're seeing in the video is the integration of the 4 solid rocket boosters, which happened recently together with the Centaur upper stage integration shortly after. NASA and ULA have provided us with some absolutely stunning pictures of the ongoing work. I don't know about you, but these pictures make me really impatient. Launch day cannot come soon enough, and I will of course stream the occasion to be able to watch it together with you. The launch is scheduled for July 20th, which leaves us with only 25 days left of staring at the clock and planning the viewing event. July 20th, though, is only day 1 of a 23-day launch window, so if the weather is bad or anything else causes a scrub on that day, NASA and ULA will have plenty days left to get the mission on its way to Mars and to Jezero Crater. Jezero Crater, by the way, has been picked as the landing site for one main reason. There is strong evidence that the crater had a lake in it for a long time. This is the actual rim of the crater, and after it was created, it filled up to create a deep lake about the size of Lake Tahoe in the United States. The delta, visible in the footage, was formed by flowing water over a long period of time. So if there ever was life on Mars, Jezero Crater is a strong candidate for finding evidence of its existence, and that's exactly what Perseverance will try to accomplish. Mars 2020 will be one of the absolute highlights of this year and the beginning of the next. No matter the day it actually launches, the landing will happen on February 18th, 2021, and the descent stage and the rover have HD cameras and microphones recording the event. This will be the first time that we can actually watch a full Mars landing sequence in high resolution and with audio. So mark the day on your calendars and get ready for an absolutely fascinating new NASA Mars mission. Normally, at this point of the episode, I do the patron and YouTube member shoutout, but this time I am pushing that to episode 101. If you have supported since the last episode, don't worry, you will of course get your shoutout as always, but this time I want to give a shoutout to everyone who has ever watched one of my uploads, streams, or anything else I have published in the last year. You rock, and I can't wait to get working on episode 101 for you. Today's special shoutout goes to Sabolch for starting an absolutely awesome project with subtitles for my episodes. You might have noticed recently that the number of available languages has gone up a lot. He's the reason. You rock. So this wraps up today's episode of What About It? How long will the rearrangement at the launch site in Boca Chica take, and will Perseverance finally find evidence of life on Mars? As always, tell me in the comments. One thing is for sure, get to the chopper. The voice is gone. Finally find evidence of life on Mars. Rearrangement moon. You rock, and I can't wait for the truck to pass.